I have a boring main title that the social mobility and educational innovation, and it will be some theoretical and methodological consideration, and I will use Hungarian data. It will be a Hungarian case study, but you will see that this framework or from this viewpoint, what I will tell you, Hungary is only a case, and I hope I can offer you a method or a solution which you can use to speak our national questions. My as a sociologist will give you a very provocative and a very aggressive question, that's a final question, that why is there anything like innovation in education at all? Because it's not a very simple question, that why is it exist at all? At the answer of the ideal teacher am I imagined that I am innovative, say a good secondary school teacher, what else is necessary for argument why innovation's gone in the educational systems? Okay, I see, but why does innovation of education became the central goal of several national policies? Because it's not subjective thing, it's that kind of innovations are in competition for sources with the agent of development of health system and infrastructure and military service and so on and so on. So it's necessary so that there is some important reason why the government wants innovative education at all. The teacher will say for me that perhaps the reason that the people realize that the old methods and means are no good, they are not enough efficient, and that's why the innovation starts in the educational system. I say that it's a joke. It's a joke. Don't say these things, that the old things has, or the old school hasn't worked. You remember the whole European and North American traditions when this secondary school system of Europe and the United States trained readers who were ready to finance book publishing of the classical romance and poems of the 19th century. Will you train better readers with the new methods of teaching of literature? It's impossible. It's impossible. Or with using the old methods, the school-trained engineers, I mean university-trained engineers, who solve the flying without electronic tools, or send man to the moon with smaller computer capacity, which nowadays has in all of our computers, or any of our computers. Really think so, that after our fantastic innovative educational methods, that will be better teachers and better engineers than the students of Platon? I don't think so. I don't think so. So my real question, why is it exist at all? I raise the assumption that there would be no policy of innovation at all if the community of schools wouldn't change over time, is to say, if there would be new groups to come time and again and knock first on the doors of high school and later on the gate of the university. That's the real reason of the innovations. Three type of new market, or three type of new men, three type of new people appear at the gates of secondary schools and later at the university. Firstly, now I will speak about only the Western world, sorry for my Asian colleagues. First, huge groups of descendants of the immigrants who has a cultural and language backwardness in the learning. There are lower social groups which has typical social backwardness, and they would like to use the school system to climb into the social ladder. And thirdly, the new higher education became non-selective for the less clever kids of upper classes too. So because of the changes of the whole climate of the higher education changed, and because of social reason, the higher education have to help the students who have cultural backgroundness or social backgroundness, it's help. That's how the society works. That's how the less clever kids of upper classes too. But the declared aim of the educational system in this situation, that we as university or as secondary school, we will teach the things. I mean, we transfer that symbolic cultural values similarly as in the previous educational system exist. But, and it's very important, that new groups interested in much less these symbolic values, that they interested only the social mobility, keep or seeing the group of C, somehow the keeping the place on the roof and nothing else. It's an absolutely new aim the aim of that new groups in the higher education, that the traditional groups which existed in the first part of 20th century or in the 19th century. So the aim, the social mobility. So, but what is the hidden aim? Let's be suspicious against not our students, but against us too. What's the real aim? What's the real hidden aim of the actors of the educational system? The real we generally declare that we like the social mobility, and we support our students because of we like the educational mobility. But there is another reason, that we are afraid from other kind of social mobility. Because what's happened in the last hundreds of years, there were some social mobility in England in the 18th century, or in United States in the late 19th and early 20th century, when new social group get to the roof without heavy and intensive educational background. They made money, or they organized gangs, or they made a revolution in the different part of the world, and they get without educational background, they became the elite of the local societies. Or, I mean, as educators and as university staff, eminently interested in, we have to canalize the growing up in the social ladder and don't let it for anybody else. Because our role in the society is bigger if the education itself will be canalized the social mobility and not other factors. Hence, it's the self-deceiving to check the efficiency of innovation in education through tests and by different other measures meant to observe the activity of schools, because these kinds of means only indicate the performance within the school instead of indicating the true degree of mobility, which is outside the performance in the school. The efficiency of innovation in education can and should only be measured by measuring social mobility. Principally, in some country and some decades, the testing of educational innovation show very good effectiveness. For example, good knowledge or good competence appear among the students. But the social mobility remains slow in that countries and vice versa. If you agreed with me, my previous argumentation, that for that groups who now climb on the social ladder, the real aim, the social mobility and nothing else. So we could make tests and we could make fantastic research that's one method or the other method, why is it good if you want to teach more about Thomas Mann or about the French Revolution. But if the outcome is not the social mobility for that groups, it will be a huge conflict with our market. Let's see how many minutes. Sorry, I haven't seen that, and I'm started.
Six more.
Yes. Okay. I would like to say a very short comment that what I would like to suggest that's a methodological aspect of the evaluating educational mobility. The typical mobility research, I mean sociological mobility research, which followed the ISE paradigm, has exit and entry mobility. But if we look at the exit mobility, our sample not enough old to check what social position reachable for their children in the future. If we use the entry mobility, the students, for example, a student sample using random sampling may, for instance, be fully representative of schools and therefore tell us what education means for a given student population, but it will not show us what education means from the parental perspective. In my I will not explain the whole story because the time is not enough for this, but in my paper you will find a method how in the waiting process in any sociological database you will find the route how you can see the educational mobility from the viewpoint of the parents and not from the viewpoint of the students. And if you believe that the real aim of the group of students, a group of the lower groups who now climb up the educational ladder, we have to know how the parents realize the educational mobility and not that what's happened in the final point. If you see it in my paper, it will be clear that the educational mobility is different in the different countries following this that method. And perhaps if you use this argument, and if you use this computing, you can compare different countries' educational mobility without any respect of the meaning of the educational innovation. And in this way, the different countries and the decades of different countries became comparable. And I think it would be a very good self-reflecting and a self-critic for any kind of educational innovator. Thank you for your attention.